Well, good evening, everyone. My name is John Ravenhill. I have the privilege of being a professor in the political science department at UW and also the director of the Bolt City School of International Affairs. It's my great pleasure to welcome you this evening to this very special event. Delighted that you could join us to participate in this event. I know it's a very busy time of year for many people. And also, I'd like to welcome those people who are tuning in online. We will be live streaming this event and looking forward to participation from our online audience as well. The election of Donald Trump as the 45th president of the United States has generated a great deal of uncertainty about the future role of the United States on so many dimensions and the implications that there will be for Canada. I was delighted, therefore, when our own president took the initiative in suggesting that we should have this panel this evening, and I'm equally delighted to have an opportunity to participate alongside our distinguished panelists. I'm looking forward to what I'm sure will be a very exciting evening. I'd like to invite Dr. Feridun Hamdullahpour, President and Vice Chancellor of the University of Waterloo, to get this event underway with some introductory remarks. Feridun.
Thank you very much, John, and good evening, everybody. I'm so delighted to see so many of you here this evening. And it's impossible nowadays not to think of the expression, maybe you live in interesting times. We have been living in these interesting times and goes on. And last year, we were surprised by Brexit and then the whole election process. It just captured the attention of the whole world and the results and afterwards what's been happening is still the main topic of conversations many, many, many places. Some of these are of great concern to many countries, but especially having our greatest trading partner here and going through some really interesting times, also a concern to us. We don't know what is going to happen from one day to another one. And we live in this very unpredictable time. So how do we cope with this? As a university, one of our main responsibilities is to provide a forum that we're able to at least shed just a little tiny bit of light. The other one is, of course, we are committed to contributing to the economic well-being of our country. And a little better understanding of our relationship with our southern neighbor, our relationship with their new president is going to be helpful. But right now, I'm pretty sure that many of you are having these conversations. Some of them probably are not very exciting. But nevertheless, I am so delighted that my colleagues and friends, they've agreed to participate in this evening's event. They are going to share their knowledge and experience with us, but also give us the opportunity to participate in what we will hear from them. So I don't want to prolong this longer. I'm so pleased that you're here. Thank you so much for being with us. But my special thanks to you, John, and our esteemed panelists for agreeing to do this. We're going to have a very, very stimulating, exciting evening. Thank you.
As the president remarked, no country is more important to Canada and to Canadians than the United States. The bilateral trade flow between Canada and the US is the largest in the world. Nearly 20% of Canada's national income depends on exports to the United States. And it's probably worth remembering, there was a lot of excitement recently about the new trade agreement with Europe, but Canada exports more to one U.S. state, that is to the state of Michigan, than it does to the entire European Union. The U.S. is the single largest investor in Canada, accounting for close to one half of all of Canada's stock of foreign investment. Now, of course, the relationship between Canada and the United States embraces much more than economics, important though that is to the welfare of both countries. We share by far the world's longest land border, nearly 9,000 kilometers. More than 400,000 people cross that border every single day. Living on the same continent means that what happens in one of the countries, and here we might think in particular of environmental matters, what happens in one country inevitably has an immediate impact on the other. The importance of the United States to Canada extends well beyond the bilateral relationship. Since 1945, the U.S. has been the most important supporter of the liberal international order, including, of course, global institutions such as those within the UN family. It's been the major supporter of an open economic order, even keeping its own markets open while tolerating discrimination against its exports by some trading partners, such as Japan and the European Union. Moreover, the United States has been the principal guarantor of the security order through the post-1945 system of alliances. One of the issues that we have to confront is to what extent is the international order as we know it now under threat? It scarcely seems possible that fewer than 50 days have passed since Donald Trump's inauguration. Such have been the upheavals. Perhaps too many people were naive in expecting that President Trump would not, on many key issues, do exactly what he said he would do when he was candidate for president. It's very clear that on some major issues, such as building the wall on the southern border, that these issues he sees as fundamental to his appeal among his core supporters, and he is going to persist with them. On the other hand, there have been some remarkable policy reversals during these first few weeks of the new administration, none more important than in the foreign policy area, where the administration has now affirmed its support for NATO and confirmed the long-standing U.S. pursuit of a one-China policy. One politician famously distinguished between core and non-core promises in justifying why he failed to keep many of the commitments that he'd made before getting to office. We have yet to see exactly what the Trump administration will decide are its non-core promises that it is willing to reverse. In fact, as the president said, there is so much that remains unclear about what policies the administration will choose to pursue and the extent to which the administration will be constrained by Congress and by the courts. The advent of any new administration in the United States inevitably brings uncertainty, some degree of chaos in the transition, in part because of the large number of political appointments, around 4,000 in total, of which 1,000 have to be approved by the Senate. It takes time to fill these positions, but it seems that the situation inside the Trump administration is more disorganized than most. Recently, I heard a senior Canadian official who was part of the preparatory team for Prime Minister Trudeau's visit to Washington asked whether the situation inside the White House was as chaotic as it was being portrayed in the media. perhaps the fake news media, his quick answer was that it was worse. It is taking much longer than usual to fill the political positions, partly because the paperwork for the necessary clearances was not done in advance. Moreover, President Trump, in the words of The Economist magazine, has a, quote, highly informal and personalized management style, unquote, which is a polite way of putting it, and seems to value a decision-making model in which multiple voices compete for his attention. He's appointed cabinet that consists primarily of old white men, relatively few of whom have substantial experience in government, and several of whom have reputations for being extremely divisive. In fact, I think I'd like to actually go to a Trump cabinet meeting. It's one of those few places nowadays where I'd be one of the youngest people in the room. Good for the ego. We do not know whether order will emerge from the current chaos, or whether the president's own style and the competing factions in his inner circle will have a lasting impact on the capacity of the administration to develop and implement coherent policies. On a number of key issues, such as tax reform and the implementation of a border tax, which I'm sure we will discuss in more detail later this evening, his own party is deeply divided. On other issues, such as trade liberalization, the president is far removed from the mainstream of his own party. Then there's the question of how will President Trump govern in the future? Will it continue to be by Twitter and by executive orders? Modern presidents have frequently resorted to executive orders to circumvent the gridlock in Congress. So if one looks at the three presidencies before Donald Trump, the average number of executive orders issued each year was 38. But while the executive has the authority to implement laws, only Congress can make them. And where executive orders trespass into policymaking or violate existing laws, then judicial challenges will quickly follow, as we saw, of course, with the initial executive order on immigration. The separation of powers is arguably one of the great strengths of the US Constitution and one that guards against the arbitrary exercise of authority. All this uncertainty poses enormous challenges for America's allies, not least Canada. What will the eventual Trump policy be on border taxes, on reform of NAFTA, on climate change? At a time when the Canadian government has swung from being one of the laggards internationally on environmental politics to wanting to play a leadership role, then the likely opposition of Washington to international environmental initiatives will pose a particular challenge. Yet the uncertainties posed by the Trump administration also offer opportunities. And I think that's something that we really should be focusing on in some of our discussions this evening. It's not all bad news by any means. Canada and Canadian institutions can lead by example. And here, if you haven't already done so, I hope that you will take a look at our president's statement on the US executive order on immigration. This emphasizes how universities are strengthened by the international exchange of talent, ideas, and experience, and how the University of Waterloo stands proudly in support of these values. The response of Canadian communities in sponsoring Syrian refugees has attracted worldwide attention and acclaim. We can lead through our own actions.
Moreover, restrictive and discriminatory policies on migration in the United States may make it easier for the local community, businesses, and universities alike to attract talent from overseas. And if the US reverts to an isolationist stance in global affairs, leaving a leadership vacuum in the international arena, there will be opportunities for creative and innovative middle powers, middle-ranking powers such as Canada, to play a creative role, as they have frequently done in the past. So, to help us go beyond the sensationalist headlines to better understand the challenges and opportunities that the new US administration will pose for us in the coming months, we have a distinguished panel of experts here this evening, and I invite them now to join me on the stage and I will introduce them. So just initially to make sure that you can start to put names to faces, I'll run through very briefly who we have here, and then I will give them a much more detailed introduction when they come to prepare their talk. So starting at the far end there, Anna Esselmont, who is from the Political Science Department at UW. Next to her is her colleague from the department, Aaron Ettinger. Then Victoria Lamont, who is from the Department of English Language and Literature. And finally, next to me, Tony Lamantia, who is president and CEO of the Waterloo Economic Development Corporation. So we're going to go in alphabetical order. Anna is going to lead off. And I'll just tell you a little bit more about Anna's expertise and her experience. Anna earned her PhD at the University of Western Ontario, where her research focused on the role of partisanship in intergovernmental relations in Canada. She's currently working as a co-editor on a volume entitled Permanent Campaigning in Canada. And permanent campaigning refers to an approach to governance whereby partisan elites who control the government apply strategies and techniques usually found in the campaign setting to the process of governing itself. So thank you, Anna, for joining us, and please come and give your remarks.
Thank you. I don't know if I should maybe use the podium. Should we use the podium?
I think they probably do for camera.
Yeah, probably good for camera. Great. The worst part of public speaking is as soon as they say something like live streaming, makes you want to run screaming, I think. But anyway, thank you very much for having me. It's great to be part of this panel. So yes, most of my work and research these days is on campaigns. So I was definitely intrigued by the campaign process in the last US presidential election. Now, there's a show on Netflix, and it's called Race for the White House. Is anyone familiar with that particular show? It's a wonderful show, narrated by Kevin Spacey. So anything narrated by Kevin Spacey is fantastic. But what it is it takes sort of a historic look at campaigns past. So past presidential campaigns, and they examine the candidates, they look at their campaign teams, analyze the tactics and what happened, and then of course you have the outcome. And I think the episodes are maybe half an hour long, so you can sort of really get into what happened between Lincoln and Douglas, for example, or Adams versus Jackson, or Truman versus Dewey, Nixon and Kennedy, George H.W. Bush versus Clinton, right? So it's this wonderful historic look at these campaigns. And so when I was thinking about tonight, I was thinking, if Netflix decided to do a show on the 2016 presidential election, what would that look like? Even if we looked 20 years from now, we're looking back at that particular campaign. And I think if you first look at the Democratic campaign, it would be that real traditional type of campaign that we're used to. And in fact, if you looked at most of the pieces, you would think to yourself, well, she should have won that. You had an experienced candidate who had a very, very good campaign team, a team that engaged in market research, who had the advantage in terms of data analytics, predictive modeling for voters. You had someone with a very strong ground game, all right? That's get out the vote, the mobilization. Once you've identified your voters, you need all of those hundreds of thousands of volunteers across the country to get you out to vote. And here's a candidate that had all of those pieces and could talk about policy and had all of this experience. And so you'd think to yourself, Netflix would grab onto that, and that would be a great, great campaign to look at. And then you would flip to the opposite side, and you would look at the Trump campaign. And so here we have an outsider. And I have now just come to accept that I cannot act as any kind of pundit for politics, because everything that I predicted was 100% wrong in terms of what the outcome actually was. When I looked back on my notes about the campaign, I was doing that the other day, and I even had lines that said, no one's gonna care about the email scandal. And I thought, oh my gosh, I gotta rethink all of this. But you think, here's Trump, an outsider, a businessman, a billionaire, someone with no political experience, and a TV celebrity. So the total opposite of what we have with Hillary Clinton. Doesn't give much credence to polls, has no ground game, was surprised when he was talking about get out the vote and mobilization, no filter in terms of what you should or should not be saying on a campaign, no support from the established Republican Party, and he would have, you know, campaign rallies instead of holding media interviews, right, or having press conferences. He would just go from rally to rally, and most campaign strategists would say, you do that when the campaign, you know, when the candidate's not feeling great, you want to just sort of give them a bump and make them feel good. And it just looked like all he wanted to do was feel good, because he wasn't actually doing any of these other pieces that we would expect. Policy via Twitter. And when we think about not doing much of that traditional media, of course, in the end, he's leading the traditional media, because every tweet, everything he talked about, the traditional media would then focus on all of those things. So he was actually in the media a fair bit. He attacked everything and everyone, including the integrity of the system itself. I mean, never had there been a candidate that had actually really publicly questioned whether or not that electoral system, whether they would accept the outcome of the American voters. So for Trump, no rule book whatsoever. And the pollsters gave him pretty much a 30% chance of winning. And I always think, well, that's a 70% chance of not winning, but of course it is a 3 out of 10 chance that you could win, and he does win. So we're still sorting out the whys of that. We're looking at the demographics, we're looking at the policy positions, we are sorting out the roles of FBI intervention and all this sort of stuff. We don't have clear answers yet. But it is a question about how that kind of campaign style really worked, right? With no rule book. So the question for me then was, in this kind of a context, can we see that in Canada? Is that kind of a candidate, would that work in our system? And I think at this point, the only test of the spillover effects are what we can see going on in the Conservative Party leadership race right now, because that's kind of the only game in town at the moment. Eventually, we'll get to the NDP, but they're slow in ramping up, so now we're really focused on the Conservatives. So 2 points here. We see spillover effects in Kevin O'Leary, in the sense that he actually kind of is very much like Trump in terms of his characteristics. He's an outsider, he's a businessman, he's a billionaire, and he's a TV celebrity. All right? On a lot of policies, he's quite different, particularly on policies that have to do with social values. but he's quite reflective of that, and he was encouraged to run after Trump had won. He also has a bit of a non-traditional way of doing things. There was a leadership debate last week. Trump decided not to take part in that leadership debate and instead it might have been French, it might have been, you know, a couple of things going on there, but he decided to hold a fireside chat instead. So bucked the traditional trend of appearing at that leadership debate, held a fireside chat in the hotel, and over 200 people came to listen to him. So he's acting a lot in Trump ways. The second person, I guess, would be Kelly Leach, right? And she is starting to take hold more of that populist appeal in terms of the Canadian values and talking about screening visitors who are coming to our country. So we are seeing some spillover effects. I would say, though, that at the moment, Maxime Bernier, who is a very traditional candidate, is still the person to beat. Right, so we have these spillover effects, but we also still see the regular trends. So I would say on this, the test will be to find out what happens in the Conservative leadership, and then the other test will be to see the provincial elections, because we will have provincial elections before we have the next general election. So what will happen in Nova Scotia? What will happen in British Columbia? What will happen in Ontario or New Brunswick or Quebec? Next year, we may see a candidate or a leader of a party that espouses Trump-like values or Trump-like campaign tactics, and maybe it'll be the case that if there is voter angst out there in Canada, we kind of get it out of our system in the provincial level. We realize that could be a mistake, and by the time the next federal election comes around, we've all come back to our senses that way. So I will leave it at that. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Anna. I realize that I probably shouldn't be hiding behind the podium here when introducing people, and actually will come up and just say a few words about them. We're moving from potential implications for what's happening inside Canada to a much higher level of abstraction now. I was joking earlier with my two colleagues here, it looks like you can't get appointed to a position in political science here unless you have initials that are AE, because we're moving from Anna Esselman to Aaron Ettinger. So Aaron specializes in international relations and foreign policy in the political science department. His recent research has been on the private military industry's role in US wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. And this is part of a broader research agenda that Aaron is pursuing on American foreign policy since 2001. And this project explores continuity and change in US policy in this period since the 9/11 attacks. So thanks, Aaron, for joining us. And we invite you to tell us all about what Donald Trump is going to do in foreign policy.
Well, thank you so much. I would like to pick up on a theme that John introduced in his opening remarks, which is the future of American world order. Right? Donald Trump, throughout the campaign and now into the first 6 weeks of his presidency, has made really troubling overtures to the rest of the world that seem to shake the foundations of many of the assumptions that have undergirded foreign policies of Western countries for the past 70 years. And this is extraordinarily troubling because if he in fact follows through on some of his more radical policy changes, we may in fact see a shift from the post-World War II paradigm to something for which there is no precedent. And to get a sense of why this is so monumental in modern history, we need to understand the role that the United States of America has played since World War II. Now, the great fear right now is that the United States might be on the verge of abandoning its post-World War II position of leadership. And with that abandonment of leadership would come fundamental challenges to the nature of world order as we know it, as everybody pretty much alive today knows it. Now, to properly appreciate what's going on, we have to return to approximately 1940. Right? And in 1940, the United States is sitting there in Washington and looking across the Pacific and looking across the Atlantic and observing the kind of chaos that unfolded in those two regions, in part as a result of the United States abandoning its role, its leadership role in the world in the 1920s and 1930s, that kind of isolationist movement that underpinned American foreign policy in the 20s and 30s. And in 1940, the United States starts talking within its own discourse that the stability of the world, the stability of America, depends on the stability of the world. And after World War II, the United States fully embraced this kind of foreign policy. Right? After 1945, the United States deliberately and meticulously constructed a complex international and institutional order that would underpin the entire Western world system, right? We all know the grand markers of American leadership, right? The creation of the United Nations, of the Bretton Woods financial order, and those pillar institutions, the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund, which still exist today. And of course, we know the others, like the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, and any number of other institutional arrangements that would be led by the United States, and anybody that wanted in would be happily invited to join the organizations. And throughout this period, the United States served as the principal provider of international public goods. It underwrote these systems, right? It, as John mentioned, offered up the dollar as the international reserve currency and tolerated discriminatory trade policies against itself so that the Western world order would find a greater trade partner in the United States than, say, the big bad Soviet Union over there on the other side of the wall. And the system that the United States constructed in the late 1940s was extraordinarily durable. Right? And it was extraordinarily durable, and this is evident through some of the crises that it was able to not only deal with, but also absorb. Right? In the late 1940s, the loss of China, the system still held. Into the 1950s, we saw the Soviet Union enter the space race and develop nuclear weapons. We saw the Soviet Union invade Hungary. We saw the Suez Crisis, which threatened to fracture the key alliances of the Western world order. Right? Throughout the 1960s, we saw the United States embark on a war in Vietnam, a mistake of its own making, but yet the system held. Into the 1970s, we saw the loss of confidence as a result of America's misadventure in Vietnam, and yet the system held. We saw the oil shocks of 1973 and beyond, which fundamentally shook the confidence in American capitalism, yet the system still held. And throughout the 1980s, the arms race under Ronald Reagan, the system held. Throughout the 60s and 70s, we also saw scores of new countries enter the world system as a result of decolonization. And this order that the United States helped to construct and lead was durable enough and supple enough that it could absorb these new countries into its scope. And this is a remarkable act of social engineering and political leadership and political foresight put together by foreign policy experts in the 1940s with a vision towards the future that was not defined by electoral cycles, but of generational change. Now, after the fall of the Soviet Union in the early 1990s, the United States faced a very distinct choice, right? The United States could return to this position of isolation that it had held before World War II. Now that the Soviet Union was gone, there really was no need to play such a forward-leaning role in the world. But the United States did not do so. right? First under George H.W. Bush and then under Clinton, the United States embarked on a very deliberate program of expanding this world order and engaging more countries and more societies at deeper levels than ever before. And what we saw was an expansion of the membership in all of these wonderful institutions that the United States had built. We saw the expansion of markets around the world, free markets for better or for worse. We saw things like the expansion of NATO from membership in Western Europe creeping ever eastward towards Russia, which would come back to haunt the United States in the year 2014. But the point here is that after the fall of the Soviet Union, the United States did not retreat into its old comfortable ways on this island of stability buttressed by two oceans and weak partners to its north and south. The United States sought to maintain this position of leadership in the world throughout the H.W. Bush, Clinton, W. Bush, and Obama administrations. The challenge that Donald Trump brings to this world order was articulated in that remarkable inaugural address that he delivered only 6 weeks ago, right? And the key phrase that I think a lot of foreign policy experts picked up on was his use of that term, America first, right? He said at this climactic moment of his speech that from here on out, one policy, one rule will govern our land. From now on out, it is going to be America first. And he repeated it for the crowd, America first. This is so profoundly troubling and potentially destabilizing because we haven't seen a world that has not had the United States at its center for the past 70 or 75 years. We don't know what an international order looks like in the absence of American leadership. And quite frankly, who else is going to provide the kinds of public goods, international public goods, the same kinds of security guarantees, the same kind of economic guarantees that the United States was able to provide over the last 75 years? Now, for foreign ministries around the world, whether allied with the United States or not, it forced them to think very seriously about their foreign policy strategies, perhaps even reorienting them in new and unconventional ways. And this is the challenge that Justin Trudeau is facing right now, alongside, particularly so, the NATO allies in Europe. To complicate these matters of the potential fall or end of the American-led world order are long-term secular trends that would have been occurring regardless of who was elected back in November. Right? One of them is trends towards a more multipolar world. Right? That unipolar moment that the United States enjoyed throughout the 90s and early 2000s is largely coming to an end. Right? With the rise of China as a serious peer competitor to the United States and a resurgent Russia in the midst, we are now perhaps seeing large-scale structural changes in the nature of global politics, which forces us to think about foreign policy in a way that we haven't done since the Soviet Union was around. And now at the same time, as we see a rise in different poles of world politics, we're seeing a decentralization of politics away from this America-centric notion of world order. Right? A decentralization of politics away from the North Atlantic Euro-American zone of politics, whereby more and more political platforms are being constructed around the world, in the global south, to do politics in ways that are not necessarily connected to the institutions and the rules and the expectations and the paradigms that were expected of American leadership. And this has really profound implications for American foreign policy and Canadian foreign policy, and I'll just name a couple. In the domain of war and peace, we can observe patterns of American engagement that are quite troubling, right? Unending, or at least seemingly unending wars in Afghanistan, an open-ended commitment to the fight against ISIS. In international institutions, we see Donald Trump openly disparaging the pillar of Western world order that was the North Atlantic Treaty Organization. We see Donald Trump speaking ill of open global trading systems. In fact, we have this extraordinarily ironic situation right now where Xi Jinping, right, the leader of communist China, is the number one state promoter of globalization and international trade. This is quite a remarkable turn of events. And of course, we have all of these hotspots, these perennial hotspots like Taiwan, like North Korea. Areas of the world that Donald Trump doesn't necessarily know a great deal about, but is more than happy to pronounce upon them, including doing things like drawing a red line, right? Barack Obama was excoriated for drawing a red line with Syria with regards to the chemical gas attacks, yet Donald Trump not too long ago drew a pretty thick red line with regards to North Korea saying, it's never gonna happen, related to their ballistic missile testing. A red line in North Korea, a nuclear-armed state with about a million forces on the border with South Korea. Is that a red line that we want enforced? Well, this is a question that remains to be seen. For Canada's purposes, the reorientation of American foreign policy is quite troubling because since the end of World War II, Canada has pegged its foreign policies to the American World Order project. Right? Canada has set its foreign policy goals and its national interests to the tune that has been set by the United States. The United States has been Canada's predominant trading partner, and Canada has set its foreign policy objectives, you could say, predominantly on the basis of open access to American markets. Right? And Canadian relations with its core allies in Europe have also guided its internationalist orientations. So for Canada, this country prefers an open, stable system with American leadership. And we haven't developed a foreign policy in 70-odd years that has not relied on that core assumption. So for scholars and practitioners of Canadian foreign policy, we perhaps are at an inflection point in our history. The traditional anchors, the traditional external anchors of Canada's foreign policy, European order and American leadership, are coming loose. If this continues, Canada is in for a great deal of trouble and a great deal of strategic rethinking of what it's been all about for the past 70 years. Or this might just be a two-year nightmare. I say 2 years because the potential of voters punishing Republicans in the midterm elections in 2018 represents perhaps a disciplining effect on the president. And I say perhaps because there is no guarantee of this at all. Right? As John mentioned in his opening remarks, the use of executive orders to run foreign policy has been a wonderful gift provided to Donald Trump by Barack Obama and by George W. Bush. And so foreign policy in the United States has been increasingly concentrated in the executive, in the office of the president, which does not portend very good things for world order under Donald Trump. Perhaps this might end in 4 years, but this is a forward vision that I am not prepared to pronounce upon because just like Anna Esselment, if I was any good at predicting the future, I would probably take it all down to Vegas. But I'm not, so I don't. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Aaron. I thought for a moment there you were going to end on a positive note, but you retreated. There are multiple dimensions, of course, to the policies of the Trump administration, and so we're going to shift gear now and look at the potential impact of the Trump administration on various cultural dimensions. I'm delighted that Victoria Lamont has been able to join us this evening. Professor Lamont was educated at the University of Alberta since 1999. She's been teaching American literature, critical theory, and literary criticism at the University of Waterloo. Victoria is an expert on historic popular culture, and this evening is going to focus in particular on issues relating to Islamophobia and how the current US administration is putting into practice ideas that have been circulating since 9/11. Victoria, thanks for joining us.
Thanks, everyone, for coming. So as I watched the Trump government roll out its first Muslim ban with blatant disregard for due process, it struck me that the world that Trump was living in is less like the world I thought I was living in and more like an episode of the post 9/11 television series 24. Has anyone seen 24? Some of you have. So in 24, Kiefer Sutherland plays Jack Bauer. Jack Bauer is a government operative who fights terrorists in a race against the clock. So what I want to do today is actually show you a couple of clips from 24 and talk about how the Trump administration is actually acting out very similar narratives, particularly around its response to paranoia around terrorism. So the first clip I want to show you is an example of a narrative that I call the terrorist next door. So this is the idea of the terrorist as a seeming, instead of that kind of sinister male or cell of males, it's this idea of the terrorist as kind of hiding in plain sight, posing as a quote-unquote normal American family doing normal things. And I think that kind of paranoia is really what Trump is mobilizing in this Muslim ban by suggesting that Muslims really need to be controlled and surveilled because any Muslim could be a terrorism. It doesn't matter how ordinary they are. It doesn't matter how normalized or Americanized they are. They're dangerous. So let's, can we play the first clip, please?
All right. This is what we have. A known terrorist named Tomas Sherrick managed to enter the country undetected. We believe there's a likelihood Sherrick helped organize a train attack in Santa Clarita. If he did, he's going to get out of the country as fast as he can.
Which means we have a small window of opportunity here. Who's covering airports and customs?
I've issued a mandate to LAX, Long Beach, and Ontario.
As usual, Edgar, we can't hear you. Also, where's your laptop in case you need to pull data?
I'm sorry, I'll speak up. And I don't need my laptop. I have everything memorized. What I was saying is that I've contacted all the airports and asked them to add a layer of security.
Do we have any local contacts for sure?
I'm looking into those now.
All right. Promote everything we receive up to division. Let's find Sherrick before he leaves the city. Let's go. Excuse me, Mr. Driscoll, do you think it's a mistake to assume that Sherrick is on his way out of Los Angeles?
No.
But the timing on the intel doesn't quite match. It said 8 a.m. and the train bombing happened around 7.
Just focus on finding Sherrick.
Yes?
It's Tomas.
The dog in the briefcase.
Yes. He's on his way to you now.
Good. You did well, Tomas.
What about Maurice?
He's waiting for you. He has everything you need.
Beirut, are you eating with us?
I'll be right down, Mom.
I'm concerned about him.
Concerned? Why?
I think he's still seeing this American girl, Debbie.
You said you talked to him.
I did. I told him he was no longer allowed to have contact with her.
Okay, so the clip that you just saw opens with the counterterrorism unit hard at work trying to catch the terrorists. And then I don't know how well you could make it out, but there's a very deliberate shot of a mosque, and then we see the presumed terrorist exiting the mosque. So there you have that equation of terrorist equals Islam that's being enacted in this narrative. And then at first, the terrorist looks like it's a sort of stereotypical idea of the lone male sinister gunman. But then we see a second terrorist who is embedded in a family. And so the logic here is that terrorists are hiding in plain sight. They're posing as ordinary people, doing mundane, ordinary things. And so in order to fight terrorism, we can't rely on the usual legal channels. And I think the same kind of logic is behind Trump's persecution of Muslim travelers and immigrants, that every Muslim is a potential terrorist. They're infiltrating American society by posing as ordinary people. And so special interventions are needed. Another clip I want to show you is an example of another narrative that the Trump administration is acting out, and it's a narrative that I call the strongman narrative. So in the clip I'm about to show you, our hero, Jack Bauer, so this is later on in the same episode, has figured out that a terrorist attack is imminent, but of course no one else believes him, and no one will give him permission to interrogate a suspect with information that can stop the attack. So let's watch the next clip and see what Jack does.
Doesn't pay off. All of a sudden, I have a ton of political fallout to deal with.
Sir, I understand that, but I wouldn't be asking you this if I didn't believe that there was an imminent threat to national security that I could help avert.
Share your concerns with Driscoll. Let CTU handle
it. Sir, there isn't time.
It's the president.
Jack, it's the president, and I gotta go. I'll see you at Vandenberg.
Yes, sir.
Los Angeles. Who are you working with?
We don't have time for this. Okay, you listen to me. Unless you start giving me some answers right now, you're gonna end up in a hole for the next 30 years.
Who are you working with? Why did you bomb that train?
How far can I push this guy?
We have to find out who he's working with. We should go as far as we have to. Maybe we should bring Johnson in.
Sorry, sir, this area's off limits.
Oh, I'm looking for Aaron Driscoll.
Now.
What is happening in the block?
Son of a bitch, he's jamming the codes.
I am not messing with you. You are gonna tell me what is happening at 8 o'clock.
So Trump may not seem very much like Jack Bauer, but he also acts the role of the strong man. His executive orders are just a more banal version of what Jack Bauer does. So instead of karate chopping a security guard and torturing a suspect, Donald Trump signs an executive order. And he also invokes this kind of sense of fake urgency that an attack is imminent and we have to bypass due process in order to be safe. And you noticed in that clip that we saw kind of representatives of democratic institutions. So we saw the politician, we saw the people who are accountable to the elected officials, and they all function there as obstacles to our safety that have to be overcome. And so Jack Bauer has to sidestep due process in order to keep us safe. And I think that the identical message is being communicated by Trump and enacted by Trump through these executive orders. So what do the parallels that I've been talking about between popular narratives and American politics mean? Well, I'm suggesting that popular narratives have a very powerful influence in our society, particularly when the wrong narratives are acted out by people in power. As I like to tell my students, I teach popular culture, most of what we think we know about the world doesn't come from real experience, but it comes from the stories that we tell each other. And while our rational minds know that these are just stories, our emotional minds don't always differentiate between reality and fiction. So for a lot of people, these kinds of messages that are being communicated by Trump, they really are resonating for them. So what might this all mean? This all mean in the Canadian context? Can the strong man or other kinds of Trumpian narratives gain a foothold here? This kind of echoes questions raised by my fellow panelists. But can these narratives start to spill over into Canada and start to influence our political culture? I'm not a political scientist, I'm an English professor, so I don't know an answer to this. But I do know from many years of studying American culture that Canadians, we like to think that we're very different. We like to think that, oh no, the Americans, they're the ones with the slavery, they're the ones with the racism, they're the ones with all that, we're nice. And we're not as different as sometimes as we like to think. So I think as Canadians, if we're concerned about the cultural influences, the Islamophobia, the scapegoating of minorities, I think we need to be vigilant in our own communities. And so when we encounter these narratives in our own communities, when we hear our own politicians kind of tapping into this discourse, I think we need to be vigilant and robust about meeting those narratives with more compassionate and progressive narratives. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Victoria. When we were putting this panel together, we wanted to ensure that we had somebody who could address the economic dimensions of Trump's policies. And we also wanted to have somebody who could say something about how they might have an impact on our local community here. We've been extraordinarily lucky in getting Tony Lamantia to come this evening. I can't think of anyone who is better placed to comment on both of these dimensions. Tony's career spans more than 25 years in large public sector organizations as well as private sector growth-oriented companies. Previously, he worked for the Ontario Ministry of Economic Development, Employment and Infrastructure, where he was the Assistant Deputy Minister of the Investment and Industry Division. Tony helped lead the ministry in both attracting investment to the province and working with industry and regional stakeholders to grow existing anchor companies such as Cisco, OpenText, Toyota, and Ford. Tony has held responsibility for the Eastern Ontario Development Fund and the new Southwestern Ontario Development Fund, which supports local businesses. Of course, now he is president and CEO of the Waterloo Economic Development Corporation. Thank you for joining us, Tony.
So, good evening. What a great conversation. You know, it's one of those talks that will keep me thinking for days ahead. So, I don't have a TV clip to demonstrate or anything like that, but when I think about policy by Twitter and some of the things that I've seen over the last few months, The movie that comes to mind is Dumb and Dumber. And in particular, you know, there's a scene where the Jim Carrey character talks about, you know, his chances with somebody that he's suiting. And I think he approaches the woman and says something like, "What are the odds of you and I getting together?" And she says, "I'm about 1,000,000 to 1. And then he says, "So there's a chance." I'm just going to take a few moments to talk about the Trump economic policy and through a lens of potential impact to not only firms in Waterloo region, but across the country. So let's start from that dynamic. And I would also say that there's an underlying tension between the economic slash fiscal policy and what we're hearing about in terms of future trade policy. So, you know, at face value, the economic policy planks, and let's just talk about four of them for starters, lower corporate taxes. So the Trump team campaigned upon lowering U.S. corporate taxes from about 35% to 15% in that neighborhood. That, in addition to accelerated depreciation, equivalent to accelerated capital cost allowance provisions. The third being a holiday for multinationals wanting to, a tax holiday for multinationals wanting to reshore capital. It's a very significant issue right now because the U.S. is, I believe, one of, actually the only country in the G7 that taxes its corporations after they already pay taxes in foreign countries. So that holiday or that being lowered or one time sort of bring your money back could be very significant, and there's something like $2.6 trillion in money outside of the U.S. That also has implications for Canada. And then the big, you know, trillion-dollar infrastructure spend, you know, big initiative. So if you take those four things, I'm not even going to talk about the regulation, you know, the deregulation that he's talking about and kind of the American industry being oppressed by, you know, bureaucrats who have no regard for how business works. Let's just park that one for a second. But those first four, in and of themselves, are extremely stimulative, right? It's not a surprise that the stock market, the U.S. stock markets in particular, have reacted on the basis of what those types of policies will mean for U.S. industry. And then this sort of, it touches upon the underlying tension because, you know, as Canadians look to the South for, you know, guidance on market opportunity, cost structure, and they do so with great anticipation because of the importance the U.S. economy plays on Canadian business, you know, you could look at that and say that the Canadian economy should benefit greatly from that kind of stimulus. You know, it would be, you know, like pouring gasoline on an underlying fire. A stimulating set of initiatives. Let's also park about how, you know, the U.S. government would pay for this stimulus for 1 second. But then you have the Trump trade agenda and this notion of America first and foreign policy you know, let's not even get into the provenance of the word America first and what it actually meant in the 1940s. And all of this stimulus could theoretically come to a full stop if goods and services are not flowing freely between Canada and the U.S. and Mexico, or worse, you know, the global economy is negatively impacted by a significant drying up of foreign trade. And, you know, therein lies an underlying tension that I think is significant. And sort of what is the impact potentially on the local economy? Well, I can tell you that since January of 2017, you know, it's kind of a mixed bag. We've had two instances that I am keenly aware of companies in Waterloo region that are foreign-owned, so, you know, subsidiary of a multinational company, both happen to be European companies, that have held off on expansion Now, these are both manufacturing companies, but they've held off an expansion after, you know, having expansion plans in place just because their headquarters have said, you know, let's just wait and see what happens. You know, one of these companies sends 90% of their products to the United States. So, you know, and you could understand that impulse, that instinct, you know, for somebody in Europe, you know, a decision maker to say to the Canadian CEO, you know, I understand that you're bursting at the seams. I understand that you found a site and you need to grow, but we're just going to hold off just in case. And the reason why that's a concern is because very often when you are not moving forward with an expansion and the market demand is there, that capacity will be filled by either another U.S. plant or by a European, you know, supplier. And then eventually the decision to not expand leads to that opportunity drying up and blowing away, you know, and that opportunity being lost. Having said that, we've also had expansion in a number of knowledge-based industries that are talent-centric. And what's going on there? I think what's going on there is a, you know, the view on the part of a number of global companies in the technology space that that it's a lot easier for talent, wherever it's from, to actually find a kind of a welcoming home in Canada. And when you're trying to, you know, disrupt new business models and you need individuals that are in the messy thick of disruption, and we're blessed to have a lot of that going on in Waterloo region, that Canada becomes a place where these new R&D mandates are becoming highly sought. And I think for the companies in Waterloo region, we have to make sure that first and foremost we understand what the impact of the Trump trade policy will likely mean. And that involves using American thinkers, American CEOs, and American governors and civic leaders, and this is what I think the Trudeau administration is actively doing, because the Trump administration won't listen to, you know, Tony Lamantia or even the Prime Minister, but they will listen to, you know, U.S. governors, they will listen to U.S. CEOs when they provide an evidence-based case for keeping the free flow of goods and services, you know, continuing. The amount of intercompany trade, the number of products and services that require that, you know, those open borders is highly significant. So the other thing I'd say is on this notion that somehow a border tax adjustment will help pay for the challenges that will be you know, hoisted upon the U.S. government in trying to figure out a way to make up for lost tax revenue or to pay for all this infrastructure is a bit of a stretch. And I say that because, you know, part of the Republican approach to this is actually, you know, it's grounded in some work done by two economists, one who's a well-known Democrat and the other who's actually a well-known Republican. And in the 1990s, Martin Feldstein and Paul Krugman co-authored a paper on this notion of, you know, border tax adjustment and how it's actually not a tariff. I'm not actually bright enough an economist or a wannabe economist to explain the difference, but I would say that, you know, the concern about that is simply that anything that actually looks like a tariff will be treated that way by other countries. And it will lead to countervailing duties and a freeze in free flow of goods and services. So that's the underlying tension. There is, you know, the Trump economic agenda could be highly stimulative. Having said that, you know, the trade policy agenda is something that we should be genuinely concerned about. And, you know, I will actually leave on a positive note, or I'll conclude by saying that you know, we are blessed by having a wonderful, wonderfully diverse set of companies. We're blessed by having in Waterloo region three very strong academic institutions. I'm actually thrilled to be here with political science professors because I spent quite a bit of time here as a political science undergrad in the 1980s, so it's wonderful to be here and actually to be in this role. But, you know, when you go abroad, the Canadian brand has never been more welcome. It's never been viewed as kind of a very cool, almost a thank God Canada exists in a North American hemisphere. That kind of a sentiment is really important. I was in San Jose with Communitech and Go North last week, and just across the board, not only the Canadian expats, but companies that are involved in knowledge-based industries view us as a community that is inventing the future, and I believe we will. But it is very important for us to make sure that we unclutter the confusion around trade policy and economic policy, and that's just going to take some time. So we're going to have to wait and see. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. You've all been very patient in listening to us. We now have plenty of time for Q&A. There are some microphones, and we'd like you to use these, please, because there are people listening online, and they won't be able to hear the questions otherwise. And while we're distributing them, if you'd like to raise your hand, who would like to ask a question, I'm going to just try and bridge the gap here by asking one question of all of our panel. And that is essentially a public policy question. We've heard about the new challenges that Canada will face with the Trump administration and its policies. So this is a nice, easy one for them. If you were advising Ottawa on how best to deal with the Trump administration in the areas in which you are particularly interested, what strategies, what policies would you advocate for our government? Well, take it in the same order.
Okay.
So, Anna.
All right, I'll begin. Part of what I've studied in the past is intergovernmental relations. So I would take this question looking at it in terms of what is the Prime Minister doing to try to strengthen ties intergovernmentally at the political level, at the staff level, for example. And I think at this point, my advice would be exactly what Justin Trudeau has been doing. So after Trump won the election, he shuffled his cabinet. And Chrystia Freeland became the Minister of Foreign Affairs, and she's got ties in the United States. She's lived in New York. She spent time in Russia. She's smart, savvy. She did very well in her previous ministerial role. So we made that move. He also promoted Lieutenant General Andrew Leslie to be her parliamentary secretary. And he has a military background. He knows many of the military advisors in the United States. He knows many of the lieutenant generals and generals in the States as well. So he's already got ties, he's able to make connections and relationships. On the staff level, Justin Trudeau's chief of staff and his principal secretary made a very quiet trip to Washington, met with Steve Bannon and Jared Kushner, and has, you know, have started to develop those relationships. It's not anything you really want to display prominently, but it's certainly something that you want to have existing so that you've got a channel of communication. He's also put in the Prime Minister's office, I think it was Chrystia Freeland's, a former staff member of hers, and he's created in the Prime Minister's office a Canada-US relations unit. And this person is sort of in charge of coordinating throughout the federal government issues that have to do with Canada and the US. So in terms of just relationships, and really, politics is all about relationships. I think that I would have advised the Premier to do exactly that, or the Prime Minister, but he wouldn't have needed it because he knows that it's all about relationships. And my husband was reminding me this morning, if we go back to a TV show just for a moment, and I realize as professors, we watch a lot of television. we had gone to the Mike Bullard Show. Anybody remember the Mike Bullard Show? So we'd gone to a taping to the Mike Bullard Show, and Jean Chrétien had been his guest. And for the entire time, Mike had really tried to push Chrétien to say that he thought that George W. was dumb.
right? Just wanted him to admit that he was kind of dumb. And Chrétien would never, like, he would never take that bait. And he said, no, that's not something, I won't say that. And he said to Mike Bullard, you know, you can say mean things about your neighbors. He says, but then you go to bed and you wake up the next morning and you're still neighbors. And this relationship, the Canadian-US relationship, is too important for Canadians across the country and would never have done that and instead just worked the same relationships the way Trudeau's doing now. So I think the advice that I would give is the advice is exactly what the Trudeau government is doing right now.
All right, thanks, Aaron. And, Aaron.
Well, I'll speak to four bits of advice, I suppose. And but first we need to, if we're gonna give advice, we need to know what we're aiming for. And I think the core interest that Canada maintains vis-a-vis the United States is economic openness. If we don't have access to American markets, it's going to be bad for everyone. And all you have to do is think back to the long lines at the border after 9/11 to get an understanding of just how profoundly problematic it is when the United States closes off the border to Canada. So what's really at stake here isn't so much the United States shutting things down, preventing Canadian goods from getting over the border by way of kind of coercive economic measures. It's really a problem of that we're trying to avoid that we can refer to as malign passivity. Right? We don't want the Canada file to be kind of put at the bottom of the dossier pile on the Canada desk at the State Department, right? Because Canada needs to engage, as Anna said, at multiple levels of politics and policy, and it's the staff level, and we need to remain engaged quite closely in a relationship that is maintained on a daily basis. So I suppose my first piece of advice would be this. Canada needs to develop a strategy towards the United States. Right, one that is clear, that is analytical, and one that is prescriptive. And I think the key to a strategy with the United States is matching interests. Right, we need to figure out what is in both of our countries' interests, and we also need to be extremely careful about not going anywhere near those core interests that the United States will not compromise on, both as a matter of policy and as a matter of politics. I would echo Anna's point about engagement all the way down through the political levels, cabinet, staff, military, and even in through to the sub-state level, right? Having premiers and provincial and industry actors engage with their counterparts on the American side of the border in order to create a favorable coalition within the U.S. that is favorable to Canadian interests. I'd also echo the point about quiet diplomacy. I mean, do not politicize politics vis-a-vis the Trump administration right now. And if you think back to the last 15 years, some of the worst relations between Canada and the United States emerged because, not as a result of the policy implications, but because of the way Canadian political leaders have articulated their policies. 2003, Jean Chrétien says no to the Iraq war, not by means of subtle phone calls to George W., but by standing up in the House of Commons and pronouncing we will not join, and then having to endure a standing ovation from his majority liberals. This did not sit well with the Americans. A similar situation happened a year and a half later when Canada rejected participation in the Ballistic Missile Defense Initiative. This was not conducted by way of mature diplomacy. This unfolded in the media on live television and in a way that irked American foreign policy makers. And it's not just the liberals. Remember when Stephen Harper went down to New York City and said that the Keystone XL pipeline was a no-brainer? Well, Barack Obama didn't so much think it was a no-brainer. And on that file, there was absolutely no progress until Barack Obama left office 5 years later. That's the kind of malign passivity that Canadian politicians risk by politicizing Canada's foreign policy. And of course, Donald Trump is, as we all know, a little bit idiosyncratic and not entirely predictable, so we don't know how he would respond to a politicized set of foreign relations. And my fourth bit is a little bit more positive, which is that Canada can pursue its own interests without selling out to the United States. We can still be leaders on climate change and on immigration and on multiculturalism and openness, but in a way that is true to Canadian values and in such a way that does not hector the United States in its current period. In fact, this might be in Canada's international best interest, because after all, people around the world, including The Economist magazine, now look to Canada as being a leader of that kind of world order that I spoke to. In fact, this moment might be a moment for Canadian political leadership in the world.
Right. Thanks, Aaron. Victoria.
Well, this is not the kind of question that English professors get asked. So it took a lot of thought, but I guess if I had him in the room, I would argue for the importance of a humanities education. So my advice is a little bit more altruistic, and it's a little bit more long-term. I was struck listening to Aaron talk about the history that's kind of being overturned or disregarded in this moment. You know, lessons were learned after World War II, and those lessons were put into place. And there seems to be this historical forgetting that's happening right now. And there also seems to be a kind of knowledge somehow isn't valued anymore. That knowledge isn't valued anymore. So I would say to Prime Minister Trudeau, you know, the humanities is, we're struggling right now. There are few jobs for graduates who are looking for careers as professors. Students are being, more and more students are believing that they can't get a job with a humanities education. And yet look at who we come to in this time of uncertainty and difficulty. We're speaking to three humanities professors and an economic guy, but also a humanities grad. So I would say that I would like to see more investment in humanities knowledge, humanities education.
Thank you. Tony.
I would continue along the existing lines. I think I would agree with other panelists that the Trudeau strategy has been the right one. And if anything, continuing to build a compelling business case, because the evidence is there. You know, there are, if you look at the Great Lakes states, if you look at a number of, you know, key industries, there is just so much at stake that the Trump administration would be foolish not to, you know, heed the advice of CEOs and industry leaders, civic leaders. And that is the case to make, you know. That's it.
Okay, thank you. Now we have two people who are sitting on the floor there. I'm sure they're tired of sitting on the hard concrete. they're waiting to deliver the microphones to you. So who would like to ask a question? There, please.
Yeah, I have a question for Aaron Ettinger. I'm wondering if you see any long-term corrosive effects for Donald Trump, given his recent allegations against Barack Obama.
Oh my, yes. the last time presidents were this nasty towards their predecessors was in the early days, the early years of the Republic, when public manners and political discourse was entirely different. And it's quite a reversal of the norm of what presidents have done once their terms have been up. Traditionally, sitting presidents have been very generous and towards their predecessors, and vice versa. This is a complete reversal of a norm that we haven't seen probably in well over 100 years. What this means for the health of democratic society in the United States is really, really troubling, because Donald Trump has given permission for a lot of nasty ideas to come out of the woodwork. And I think the last thing we want to do is turn partisanship into an intergenerational kind of presidential practice. That's not healthy for democracy at all.
Can I just, I'll jump in for 1 second. There's a great book, I don't know if you've read it yet. It's called The President's Club. And the argument of the book is essentially that the only people who know what it's like to be the American president, to have the weight of the world on your shoulders, to have to make these decisions that have rippling effects across the globe, are former presidents. They are the only people that truly understand the isolation that can occur and just the weight of making decisions. And that's why it's an important point here that it might be the political inexperience for Trump, but he may not realize, because he's surrounded by lots of people and he's in the spotlight, just actually how isolating that particular job can be. And it might be an action that he will end up regretting when he needs advice about his job, and the only people that can give it to him are former presidents of America.
Okay, I think there was a question there, please. Yes.
Good evening, and thank you very much for this nice panel from everybody. You only need to be a traveler to feel what it means to be a Canadian. I'm in education, and I travel the world doing school improvement or school inspection. And every country I land in, and many of the countries I travel for to visit family, they all say, what a beautiful country, what a great system, and lately, what a handsome young prime minister. So just imagine, this is our golden opportunity now. We need to open not only our doors, but also our windows. We've already been an exemplar to the world regarding the refugees. We have been an exemplar. So we can be the same thing in politics, in trade, in economics, in education, and in all, and on all level. This is our opportunity now. What if, just imagine, what if with the temperament leading the south the border, something may, God forbid, goes wrong, very wrong, and they close the borders, where do we go? We have to open the windows and doors to the world, every part of the world. Look at the economics, look at the Far East, look at the demographics of age. Where is the power, where's the energy, where's the money now? We need to open up, and I believe this is our golden opportunity. Question, no, I said, sorry, I wanted to say it's a reflection, really. After listening to you all, I think this is our golden opportunity, particularly to Aaron, who talked about this. This is it. And we need to capture these moments and shine in the world. Many, many contracts, I was in many contracts in the Near East, the Middle East, Americans were not wanted. They wouldn't even give them contracts. They only chose Canadian. So we have to capitalize on this. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Would somebody like to comment on that? Victoria, I mean, the cultural dimension of that?
Yeah, totally. I mean, I kind of have a naive question, but there is the rest of the world out there. So I'm wondering if this isn't an opportunity to kind of rethink. So this is a question for my political scientist friends, but isn't there an opportunity to sort of rethink where we stand in the world and maybe look for opportunities for relationships elsewhere so we're not so reliant on Americans?
Yeah, I mean, Canada's been doing a pretty good job at that. I mean, mm-hmm. Stephen Harper began the process of a free trade agreement with Europe, and the Trudeau government, brought it home as a way of diversifying Canada's economic relations. And at the same time, that decentralization of global politics is also a trend that Canada should get in front of. right, by engaging with the more obscure kinds of regional clusters of political practice that we don't hear about on a regular basis, because these are the new and emerging platforms in which politics takes place, not necessarily in the headlines and not necessarily among things you've ever heard of, but that's where it's happening, especially in the parts of the global south that are experiencing boom times.
Mm-hmm. Okay, there's a question there, please.
Thank you very much. I have quite an extensive question. It's supposed to be three. I'll try to combine all three, and hopefully I'll get them across. Anna, you were talking about politics is all about relationship. And as much as I agree with you, I'd like to extend that and say politics is about relationships, but it's also about positionality and what we consider to be normal. Mm-hmm. By that I mean Trump's no plan, no strategy success has been possible because of his positioning in the society. And when you look at what I've studied in terms of voice and power. There's certain people, because of their position in society, when they speak what we call discourse analysis, they weigh the words from their mouth carry more weight than others. And Trump finds himself in that position where his narrative has been accepted because he's considered to be a normal person in this dominant society that we live in. My question to you, first question is, would this have been possible if Trump had been a black person?
Hmm. No.
Question number two. Question number two to Aaron and Victoria especially. Victoria, you were talking about the narratives. We said what we learn, the stories we tell each other. I hope I've quoted you correctly, but.
Pretty close, yeah.
Okay, but there are certain stories which are submerged, which are silenced, which are not heard.
Yes.
Again, goes back to what we consider to be normal and what is yes. acceptable in a community. And Aaron, you were talking about decentralization of politics and the emergence of other platforms. As much as I enjoy that, coming from the global south, I find that's very contradictory, because in places where I have grown up, when we talk about decentralization, we're talking about post-colonialism. Mm-hmm. And in the north, they're talking about globalization, which is a clash as far as we're concerned, because we're talking about nationality and globalization is talking about wiping away nationhood. So I'm a little confused. I'm saying to myself, how do we participate, when I say we, even though I'm Canadian, how are the people in the global south participate in this dichotomy that I see prevalent in world affairs? Thank you.
I'll take the question first.
Sure, I can just do a brief response. I take your point, and I would say, so what's interesting about Trump and the power and the voice is that there's a celebrity aspect to Trump. And American culture is pretty deep in their celebrity culture. But I would say the same was true of Obama in 2008. He had power and he had a voice. His message was vastly different from what Trump's was. And if you remember back to that campaign, McCain even had a commercial that talked about how he was like Paris Hilton. Right, all Obama had was celebrity, and he, you know, they would do a clip when he was in Germany, and there were, you know, hundreds of German citizens who would come to hear him talk, and it was a whole montage about how he wasn't ready to govern, right? Wasn't ready yet. He didn't have the experience to do it, but this was a celebrity, and we can't get caught up in the celebrity. So I think in some ways there are parallels, because Obama had power and he had a voice, but his message was different. And what I would add to that too is that I don't want us to get, again, we're feeling, you know, a little low about what's happened, but we also have to remember that more people voted for Hillary Clinton than voted for Donald Trump. And there are millions of Americans who are very concerned about what's going on in their government. They are concerned about their president, and they are people like you and me
who have, you know, different views from Trump and were very worried about what happened in that election. So we also, I think, want to hold on to the fact that those who did turn out to vote actually supported her in higher numbers. So there's hope within that within that culture there.
Aaron?
So, to the question about globalization v. Decolonization. Yes, I mean, I accept that this contradiction exists in world politics, but that's sort of the nature of world politics. Like, logically, none of this should work, but the international system can sustain all of these paradoxes and contradictions and yet still move ahead. The advice that I was giving is being spoken from the perspective of Canada and Canada's national interests in engagement and in expanding relationships.
I think we're going to have another panel on that, right, actually. We're moving a long way beyond President later. Trump. Question at the back there.
Thank you. Before the question, I want to thank you for having hosting this, because in this fake news day and age, it's very hard to listen to a very intelligent conversation on American politics. So congrats on that. My question is sparked by something that Aaron mentioned. The Trump presidency might last 8 years, it might last 4 years, or it might last 2 years. But for that to happen, two things are required. First, the Democrats must ensure a supermajority in the Senate, and they must get over gerrymandering to make sure they have a simple majority in the House of Representatives. And so this is a two-part question. First, do you see this happening? Are you, quote-unquote, optimistic that this may happen? And the second question is impeachment desirable? Because the alternative, as you know, is Mr. Trump's vice president, which some might argue might be even worse. What's the panel's take on this?
I'll keep it really, real simple. Is it going to happen? No. And it's not going to happen because it requires two extraordinary things to occur. It would require large-scale switches in voting preferences in the midterm election, which can happen, but as you mentioned, there are all sorts of constraints on that. And second, will an impeachment happen before the 2020 elections? Unlikely, because it's a very long process. So I'm not especially enthusiastic about the probability of that happening.
Any other comments? Okay, I think there was another question right at the back, was there? And then we have one here, thanks. And another one there. Okay, we'll try and get this organized. Yes, please.
Hi there, I'd like to thank you all for the panel. It was very informative. I'm just wondering if, from the perspective of academics, if this administration presents a new challenge to the way we should kind of anticipate the future. The only reason I ask this is because at the recent CPAC conference, advisor, I guess, Stephen Bannon, former editor, editor of Breitbart News, was mentioning that his vision for the future of the United States would be the deconstruction of the administrative state. And I'm wondering how that would necessarily cascade into these other areas that you've all spoken about. So in terms of foreign policy, mentioning the world order as it currently is with the United States as a leader, I'm just wondering if those positions are still tenable given this vision that is seemingly already underway with some of the executive orders that have already been signed. So thank you.
Do I want to
take that?
I don't know.
Aaron?
Okay. This deconstruction of the administrative state line, man, that is a pile of academic garbage. Right? It sounds really brilliant, but you don't know what it means because it's a fairly empty phrase. Right? What he's really talking about is deregulating the market. Steve Bannon does not want to deconstruct the security state in the United States and the administration therein. In fact, he wants to ramp up the security state and, in all likelihood, expand it. So I look dimly upon that phrase. as academics, what can we do? Holy smokes, this is a profoundly difficult question to answer, because it's a matter of personal ethics and professional conduct. I'll just give you the most recent example in my line of work. The International Studies Association conference was held a couple of weeks ago in Baltimore, and it was held right after the travel ban was blocked by the courts. And we at our various subcommittee sessions talked extensively about how we can make our community of scholars more inclusive to academics from around the world who are going to be negatively affected by this ban. And it's extraordinarily difficult to do because of the immense power of the American states and our relative weak position vis-a-vis what a man like Trump can do on a whim.
I would also like to speak to the question. I think I'm seeing a lot of my colleagues realize that we have to get more activist. Steve Bannon is also a white supremacist. It just doesn't make sense to me in my classrooms to teach my students about the construction of race and the history of race, and then sort of stand by while white supremacy is enjoying a resurgence in North America. Some of my colleagues in the English departments have started organizing events. We had an event a couple of weeks ago after the attack on the mosque in Quebec. I've really been thinking about how I can put myself out there more. And I'm sort of an introverted person. I'm not, you know, a kind of activist. I'm not kind of comfortable protesting outside of businesses, but I think it's really made some soul searching about how I can better align my academic work and my political actions and political ways in the world.
There was a question in the middle there, please.
Hi, good evening. This is a question for Professor Victoria. Do you think the attack of the mosque in Quebec is an effect of Trump's narrative? And if so, do you think that Trump's narrative will have deeper implications in Canadian society?
I see it already happening, albeit on quite a small scale. So there was, I'm sorry, I can't see the person who asked. There you are, I want to be looking at you. So we saw the demonstrations in Toronto, first an Islamophobic group coming out to demonstrate. And one of the things I was disturbed about there was that what the media reports described an Islamophobic demonstration as a protest. That is not a protest. That is an act of racial discrimination. So there needs to be maybe more awareness about how language is deployed there, so as not to. I can't speak to the what happened in Quebec. I mean, these crazy folks, they glom onto narratives and then they act them out. So yeah, in a way, I think the Trump narrative was engaged there, but you still need the other ingredient there is a violent, disturbed person. I don't want to see it gain a foothold in Canada. I think we really need to be vigilant about intervening in those narratives, countering those narratives, putting ourselves out there in public spaces, putting our bodies out there so that these narratives don't gain the kind of traction that we've seen them gain in the United States.
Okay, thanks. There's a question there.
uh, Thank you. Well, I have two questions, please. The first is related to the announcement that was made regarding the state, the Department of State budget, and cutting the budget in the United States. What what do you see of the implications of such a decision? And the second question is regarding Canadian foreign policy. In February, there was a discussions between Canada and China on the free trade agreement. So there are some steps also that has been taken during the last few years between Canada and China to build or strengthen the relations between the two countries. So how do you see what's happening in the United States influencing Canadian foreign policy vis-a-vis new emerging powers like China? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Well, maybe we can ask Tony to say a little bit about the economic dimensions, sure. The possible free trade agreements with China, what alternatives there are now that the TPP is dead.
So let's start with this notion that that China is an emerging power. I mean, certainly as far as industrial might, that would be the case. But I was having this conversation earlier with one of the panelists. I am convinced that the United States will continue to be our most important trading partner and a critical global player for decades to come. And I say that because, China's banking system, in my view, has been recklessly built. I would say that, China has a ways to go before it actually has a chance to become, for the Chinese want to become a reserve currency. I believe that the opportunity lies in the ability of Canada to continue to maintain multilateral and bilateral relationships with trading partners that that share some of the same objectives that we share. I would say that one of the reasons why the U.S. Doesn't seem to have Canada in its trade crosshairs is because we have by and large been a compliant trading partner. We don't have a long history of huge trade surpluses. We don't have poor or kind of weak environmental regulations, and so I would say that while it's very important for us to continue to diversify our export markets and to be able to work from a trade policy standpoint to improve our trading relationships with countries such as China and Europe, and obviously the bringing home of CETA is very promising. I think that we're kidding ourselves if we think that that's somehow going to make up for a declining trade relationship with the United States. We have to be very, very careful not to overestimate the benefits of two-way trade with China and or the EU in the near term. And that's what I would say.
On the budgets. Obviously, we're seeing very extensive reallocations across different departments, decline in state, huge increase in defense, huge budget for the wall.
Great observation. And what is being done to the Department of State is completely consistent with the kind of ideology that Donald Trump and his more ardent supporters in cabinet bring. And we can generalize this and just call it a conservative nationalist foreign policy. And this is one that sees greater value in engaging in world affairs with the military and less with diplomacy. So cutting back the budgets of the Department of State is completely consistent with what you would expect out of this crew.
We have a question there, please. We're actually going to have to. Maybe what we'll do is gather three questions together, and give our panel a chance to answer these, because we only have about 5 minutes left for this session. So if we can work wonders with the microphones, and I think there's somebody been waiting a long time at the back there as well.
Sure. I was just wondering if, with the current benign attitude of Trump towards Trudeau and Canada in general, I was just wondering if you thought it was possible for us to be overestimating or overstating the effect of the president on Canada as a whole. And I'll leave that to whoever wants to take it.
Okay, thanks. And there are two or three questions. Actually, let's take the one there, please, in white.
Thank you. My question's for Tony, actually, and I'm wondering if we can take a look at this as what can be positive that we can look at for Canada, maybe particularly for our region, in terms of your initiatives around the Go North, come back home. What do you see maybe in terms of a movement of maybe people wanting to move back here, bringing businesses back here? Will there be a positive? Can we look at a positive economic development from this?
Okay, and there were a couple of questions, gentleman here, lady there, and that will have to be it, I'm sorry to say.
Thank you. I wonder if anyone could make a comment on the appointment of Betsy DeVos as the education secretary, and what the implications of that is for public education in the United States.
Right. And last one there, thanks.
My question is for Tony. I come from Kenya, so sub-Saharan Africa, and there's a massive drought going over there now. And my question is in relation to climate change, and there's been narrative that climate change is a hoax and all that kind of issues going on. And also now after the election, with the appointment of Secretary of Energy and all that, and the pulling down of climate policy from the website, there's a suggestion that there's a significant shift of climate policy from the Trump presidency. And my question is, what should be Canada's response in the face of Trump's position in climate policy? Should Canada remain tough on climate change policy, or should they pull, as been suggested by some people from, I think, Saskatchewan, saying that Canada will lose if it continue to economically, will lose economically if they continue to remain tough. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So let's begin with Tony.
Okay, so on the first, regarding are we kind of overestimating the impact of Trump, and is, I'm going to call it maybe conflate the two. The other question about is this a unique opportunity for us to benefit? I would say absolutely yes on the latter. I think this is a once in a generation opportunity to showcase our value proposition to the world, but more importantly for those Canadian expats who are working in the United States and haven't been to, you know, let's make it about Waterloo region, haven't been back in 20 or 30 years, the place has changed a lot, you know, it really has. And it's not only about, the quality of life, the diverse, welcoming community, things like a fractured tailgate debate, which we seem to have in the United States, where there's no kind of compassion, there's no listening. That actually impacts a lot of Canadians. I spoke to a number last week who are basically mystified by the rancor, the caustic political discourse. And, and to make things even more compelling for these Canadian expats, we actually need their skills. I mean, I can count on one hand, five firms that I know that are looking for north of 2,000 people in Waterloo region, if you add them up. So this is a wonderful opportunity for us to make the case. I think it's a strong case. Whether you're talking about the market opportunity, cost structure, and talent for companies and individuals, and the ability to attract and retain talent because of the quality of life, it's huge. We're also mystified. I certainly am when I hear the the vituperative conversation around healthcare in the United States, and kind of the back and forth around. The other day, I don't know which American politician basically said, well, you know, if you can choose between having an iPhone or between having healthcare, which I thought was, you know, really interesting. And the response to that on Twitter, and it's just not something that we worry about in this country, and I think we take it for granted. And, you know, I have a bag full of anecdotes that I can share. I worked for two different U.S. companies, and part of the conversation in San Jose last week was, you know, trading stories about healthcare nightmares in the U.S. that either we have experienced or friends have experienced, and actually trading wonderful stories about, you know, social and economic life in Waterloo region. And I think that it is a it's a very exciting time to be in the job that I'm currently in. But it's also a time where I think we have to stay positive, have faith in you know, the wisdom of the American people. And, you know, I don't think we can, you know, we can give up on our partners to the south, because we're already seeing, or I've certainly have seen, that there is, you know, over and above the rhetoric, there's still a lot of kindness and a lot of, you know, social advocacy for individuals who voted for Trump, but are also trying to, you know, protect community members from being deported to other countries, whether it's Mexico. You're seeing that, you know, that you know, what actually happens when people figure out that it's their community. You know, there's a face around the individuals being impacted. A number of very socially minded initiatives happen, and so I have a lot of faith in the ability of the American people to, you know, eventually get it right. And and I also believe that on the last question about climate change, that Canada in particular can continue to play an important leadership role. You know, the reality is that as much as the Trump rhetoric focuses on kind of, you know, clean coal and we're going to bring these coal mines back, you know, the reality is that the economics aren't there. There are so many different you know, lower cost resources, not to mention what's happening in renewables and technology, that in a way that, you know, there's been a bill of goods sold to coal miners or coal mining families who actually think they're gonna get brand new coal mines in the United States. Not gonna happen, period, full stop. In much the same way as, you know, the assembly plant worker in Ohio who is welding and making $25 an hour, that job is ever going to come back. It's not. You know, there are robots that do that for, you know, 1/10, 1/20 of that. And it's that kind of bill of goods that, you know, eventually there's an expression that Warren Buffett uses, and I like it a lot, and that is, it's not very flattering when you're thinking about it in terms of the Trump presidency, but when the tide comes in, you could see who's swimming naked. And I think the reality is, I don't know why I said that, but anyway, I did. But, you know, after a while, the reality of the impact of the policies and the difference between the rhetoric and what actually happens is gonna matter, and journalists and you know, commentators and Americans, they'll figure it out, and so that's why I have faith that that they'll eventually get it right.
I think that's a very appropriate upbeat note on which to end. We are out of time. I'm really sorry that we have to cut it off. I think the fact that we're still going strong 2 hours after we began, that there are still lots of questions that we haven't been able to take, is testimony both to the importance of the topic, but also to the wonderful answers and contributions that our panelists have made. So please join with me in thanking all of our panelists. And I'd like to remind you that there is a reception now, and so you will have a chance to really ask that question about the Education Secretary again. People may be more willing to give you a frank answer in private on that one. But please do join us. The reception is just behind here, I believe. And thank you all again for coming out on this cold evening. Thank you.